Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Locandy. Today we're with Senator Mark Grisanti, your voice in Albany. Senator, how are you today?
Doing pretty good. We've got a few weeks left. We've got to make sure that we continue on our path of cutting taxes, creating jobs, making New York a better place to live and grow. So we'll see what happens in the next few weeks.
Yeah, so let's start off. You sponsor the Protect Our Children's Act. Let's go right out to the floor to hear your explanation.
Thank you.
What you have before you is a piece of legislation known as the Protect Our Children's Act. And basically it addresses the problems of serious forms of child abuse that are not adequately covered under existing law. This legislation actually fills and takes care of some of those gaps. Many existing statutes are so overly complicated as to be practically useless or carry such disproportionately low punishments. It actually permits serious child abuse cases to go essentially having no meaningful consequences whatsoever. So current misdemeanors and nonviolent felonies with probationary sentence do not do enough to save or protect our children from the cruel or repeated maltreatment of individuals. This bill fixes these problems in a measure that's concise, creates new felonies, increases penalties for existing crime that include aggravated manslaughter of a child, aggravated abuse of a child, aggravated murder of a child, obstructing the location of a child who is missing, concealment of death of a child, and aggravated endangerment of a child. These are all, believe it or not, throughout many, many decades, laws that have been lacking to protect our children or that have absolutely little of consequences when somebody is charged with these crimes. It seals up these loopholes and protects our children. I urge all my colleagues to vote in the affirmative, and I actually ask you to contact your assembly members to pass this vote to protect our children.
So this passed the Senate last week.
It passed last week, and it's passed the last 3 years. And it's just, I mean, it's unbelievable that the assembly does not take this up. I mean, I don't really see anybody on the assembly side speaking out against the bill. We don't have any opposition to the bill. I mean, straightforward, these are loopholes in the law that protect children. I mean, we're sealing up these loopholes. I mean, concealment of death. The only thing that we have are civil laws that go against coroners or funeral home directors, okay, if you do something with regards to a body that's dead or something along those lines. And actually, we had cases like that where they, funeral directors, you know, you read about that where they will take either the urn of ashes or something like that, and it's not really that person's urn. Those are civil proceedings that you have.
Is that part of the Amanda Lynn's law that you've been trying to get passed?
Right. There's language in here right now, also in this bill and Amanda's bill, which I can't believe that they don't take that up either, that is very, very simple. I mean, Amanda Winkowski, we've talked about this before, a young woman found naked in a dumpster. She did not get there by herself. She had to be, killed at some of the location. And wherever that location was, there was a crime scene, and that crime scene was disturbed. So this legislation, as well as Amanda Winkowski's law, goes ahead and says that if you were to move a dead body, a corpse, or a body part, it goes even that depth, you could be charged criminally because something happened at one scene, you're going to another scene, and that scene is not going to give you any evidence. So you're disturbing evidence, so on and so forth. Not notifying law enforcement within at least 24 hours if a child, has been missing. We kind of took this language from Florida, where we had that nationwide case where nobody knew where the child was, nobody knew where the child was. And at trial, it comes out, she was here all along. She drowned in a swimming pool. It didn't make any sense. I mean, I'm not going to go against what the jury decided in that case. But the point is that these are loopholes that are strengthened. It gives the district attorney's office a better chance of a conviction. It gives the district attorney's office a better chance in going against those repeat child abusers. And in reality, on the defense counsel side, I mean, they understand then what the law is, and they know how to proceed forward whatever defense they have for their particular client. But these are loopholes that we need to take care of.
So a child abuser, just thinking about that, could, get off, go back into the house, and then what does that do to the child that was abused?
Right, exactly. And so, I mean, the assembly, I don't get it. I mean, we have a lot of anti-crime legislation And for some reason or another, they just do not want to put it in there. And, you know, some of our laws are antiquated where you need to fill these loopholes. I mean, especially in today's day and age with technology, things are changing. And you gotta fill these gaps. If you don't fill these gaps, you're going to have people that are not only hurting children, but also adults stealing your privacy, doing certain things along those lines on computers. And we need to stay up with the times on this legislation.
You recently signed on as a co-sponsor of the Compassionate Care Act. Can you tell us what brought you to this position?
You know, I came out very early on in support of the Compassionate Care Act. When we had hearings up here in Albany, I mean, I wish those that are against the Compassionate Care Act, if they saw and witnessed the parents giving the testimony with their young children by their side, who right in front of you were having a seizure. And these seizures were not lasting like a minute. They were lasting like 10, 15 minutes. And to see a young child stiffen up and tighten, and you can see the pain. Mm-hmm. And the parents, the parent would still talk, but then the parents and the friends who were with them would go and comfort their child. That was powerful. And there were some recent changes that were made. Those changes, I believe, strengthen legislation to be the most strongest in the nation. Not only regulated, Department of Health's involved. You know, there was things talking about the New York State Department of Taxation and Finance with excise taxes. You know, the Assembly passed the bill. But when they pass the bill, they don't go through and see what sort of fiscal costs are involved with each department in the state. Now it's in our Finance Committee. It came out of Health. Finance will look into that. You have to see what the cost is, if they have the programs that they get set up with regards to the Department of Health, the programs that need to be set up with regards to collecting the tax. You know, there's a lot of things involved with it. But we shouldn't lose sight that, in particular, the oil that's involved, that's extracted from the plant, which has 0.01% of THC, where you would need a telephone pole's worth in a short period of time as a dose on a child to be affected. It has no addictive properties, this oil, and it's been proven and shown time and time again, not only in Colorado but other states, and other neurologists are getting on board with this, that in fact it does help limit seizures. Where a child's taking maybe 15 medications, child may only have to take maybe two or three, and their seizures are reduced from maybe 100 to 300 a day, if you could imagine that, down to maybe two or three every other day. And that's consistently what's been shown. And the other side of it, the smoking aspect. Now, I don't want people to be misunderstood here, because this doesn't mean that somebody's going to be able to go into a pharmacy and be able to purchase marijuana. This is highly regulated, and it is geared towards those with specific illnesses, rheumatoid arthritis, MS, AIDS, cancer. The smoking, and it's got to be over 21, but the smoking aspect is such that it allows those individuals relief in a different aspect. Those individuals suffering from those diseases, they don't feel like they're even part of their own family. I mean, they basically, they're on so much chemotherapy or radiation treatment or medication. They're not hungry. They don't want to eat. They want to sit in a room. And their quality of life is nothing. Those that are able to obtain access to medical marijuana and smoke it, or there's pill form as well, say that they're eating, they're feeling more strength. It allows them to face the next doses of whether it's radiation or chemotherapy, but also the next rounds of medicine that they have to take for their illnesses. Rheumatoid arthritis, it relieves the pain and the stiffness, is what's been shown. So, you know, I know that there's medical on both sides of this, but there's no reason why we shouldn't have access to it to allow that particular physician to make the decision whether or not the oil or the smoking aspect of marijuana is something that can help out their patient to lead a more productive life and to be pain-free. That's all this legislation does. Doesn't legalize it, doesn't do anything along those lines, and that's where the misnomer is, and people have to realize that.
Another thing you would like to see is CPR in schools. Tell us why.
You know, again, you hear the stories, you know, a kindergartner, Madison, whose mom was up here to see me, whose daughter, they thought she had fainted. Apparently she was out, I think, several minutes. I think it was over 10 minutes. And nobody, my understanding, checked to see if there was a pulse. If they would have, They could have possibly performed hands-on CPR. Hands-on CPR is something that is so fast to learn, so easy to learn, and it'll stick with you the rest of your life. CPR in schools is something that is designed to not only have every student take it, but naturally the teachers and the administrative staff are going to be learning it as well. You could use that in the school, outside the school, at a restaurant, on an athletic field, something along those lines. And it's been shown that that it works. I mean, there's over 450,000 people. They suffer cardiac arrest. Only 10% actually will make it. By providing hands-on CPR, what I mean by that, it's not blowing in the mouths. I mean, it's come a long way. It gives you 2 to 3 times more chances of actually surviving this hands-on CPR. And the cost, if there is any, is minimal, because you could teach it during a health class, you could teach it to a gym class. It takes as less time to view a 30-minute, whether it's an infomercial or a sitcom, you could learn this. And in my area, in Western New York, not only are the volunteer firemen, the ambulance, the EMS, they actually come to the school. They have the materials and they'll teach you. Young lady from Orchard Park started this in Orchard Park. She taught her classmates in Orchard Park. She went on to Clarence School, taught students over in Clarence. And it's just something that's a no-brainer. I mean, this can save lives. And when we were when we had them up here in the well, it was very disheartening. On one side, you had those that survived, and on the other side, you had those that did not survive. And for all those kids, my hearts and prayers, you know, go out to them, especially, you know, Madison. I mean, she was a kindergartner. And this is something that could save our lives. On the other side, you had older children who collapse on athletic fields where somebody did know and they performed this hands-on CPR.
As you got up to show your support, let's take a look at that right now.
You're going to see a lot of individuals from around this great state of ours in the LOB and in the well that have blinking hearts on their lapels. Those hearts signify what they are trying to do, and that's passage of CPR teaching in high schools. Now, you may not think about it, but you should listen to some of your constituents that are coming to see you today. Tell them to talk to the assembly members to get this taken care of. 16 states now require students to learn CPR. If given right away, CPR doubles or triples survival rates. Nearly 424,000 people have cardiac arrests outside of hospitals every year, and only 10.4% survive. It's easy, it's fast, it's simple to learn. We've done pilot programs in our area in Western New York. We have individuals here from the Western New York region. JJ, I want you to stand up. This young man is here today, is alive today, because he was given CPR while basically at cardiac arrest in high school. He's alive here today. He's a strapping, tall young man. Those are his parents next to him. We have the rest of the group with their flashing heart lapels. There's more. This is something that's a no-brainer, my fellow colleagues. CPR in high school saves lives. Imagine having tens and tens of thousands of students that know CPR. They could be anywhere. They could be in a restaurant. They could be on the street corner. They could be in the high school. They could be in college. Somebody goes into cardiac arrest, they'll have the skill to give that individual, that man, that woman, an extra 4 to 5 minutes of life and the possibility of staying alive. So I want to thank you for your advocacy, JJ. Fantastic. I want to thank your parents, everybody that's here, for the advocacy. Mr. President, thank you very much. And whoever wants to join on the resolution, and please help get this law passed. Thank you.
So yeah. Sometimes all you need is just that time to get the EMS people
right.
There.
Right, and it's not a mandate. All this bill does is allows us to go to the State Department of Ed and regions to see, you know, what's best to implement the program. And so, I mean, it's a no-brainer.
Right. Last time you were on, I brought up that you were honored by the ASPCA and how you treat and look after animals. Let's show our viewers what you said to your colleagues on the Senate floor.
If you were down in the well, you saw a lot of our four-legged friends really having a good time. And if they came up to you and kissed you, that means they appreciate the support and all the legislation we've done in the past. If they bit you, that means you voted negative on that legislation. So trust me, they know. But it's important that we speak for them and for all breeds and all degrees. We've done some tremendous legislation in the past, from having accountability also legislation dealing with review of procedures. There's legislation that's going to be passed today that has more accountability for the animals across New York State. A lot of people don't realize it, but it's important because you see something horrific on TV, some sort of abuse, some sort of crime against animals. You know what? When it comes down to it, it ends up costing those not-for-profits, the taxpayers of your villages, your towns, and your cities. It ends up costing them money. So this legislation strengthens that we've passed in years past, we're passing today.
So you talked about how it could save taxpayer money?
You know, absolutely. I mean, this legislation isn't just done. I mean, you know, it basically, like we had for the puppy mill legislation, Phoenix's law, animal abuse registry, other legislation that has accountability, basically makes sure that if somebody is convicted or found of animal abuse, then they're going to have to pay the cost back for the treatment that that animal had to receive while the court case was proceeding. So it's important. Again, these are loopholes in the laws that we're trying to get straightened out. So I was proud to accept that award from the SPCA, and I quite frankly couldn't have done it without them and all their supporters from the SPCA and the other humane groups to make it sure that we get this legislation pushed forward. And apparently I'm ranked up there as one of the senators that has a lot of legislation dealing with animals and animal abuse. So I don't have a problem with that. I have, you know, dogs at home myself. So, I mean, I respect that, and I respect them coming to me with these problems.
Yes. Thank you so much for being with us, Senator.
Pleasure. Have a great day.
You too. Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator Mark Grisanti. For additional information on what we discussed, grisanti.nysenate.gov.